Hachette Audio presents The Bitter Crown, The Eidyn Saga, Book 2, written and read by Justin Lee Anderson. For truth, and everyone who fights for it. A story of a lost war. The old boy scans the busy bar with a mischievous grin and settles back on me with a sparkle in his eyes brighter than the meager candle lighting our table. He ducks his head as if the dark, low-hanging beams might eavesdrop. A sup of his ale, a conspiratorial glance under bushy eyebrows. When he speaks, his deep voice hums with the excitement of a child bursting to tell a secret.
Aye, you think you ken the story, don't you? We all think we know what happened. But the truth of it, I've met people, heard stories. See if they're true. Nothing we've been told is real. None of it.
He twitches with anticipation, running a hand over his head, searching the room again for eyes that linger too long, ears that hear too much, hands that reach for weapons or irons. After a moment, he licks his teeth and, inevitably, the tale spills from him.
So after a year of fighting off his demons and dead, Minagog was trapped in Dunedin, right? That's where we start. Aye. So, after all that's done, King Janaeus puts together a new king's council. Laird Aranok, a soldier by the name of Glorbad, a sailor called Nyria, and Brother Meristan, the head of the White Thorns.
I nod. I know this. Everyone knows this.
First thing he does is send them on a secret mission, though. See, apparently, old Queen Tanithia of Gaul was secretly still biding in Barrett Castle, and Janaeus reckoned they could help get her back on the throne and make an ally of Gaul.
Except Meristan had they turned up.
So it was just the three of them, plus Alandria, Aranok's bodyguard, and a wee blacksmith Aranok had sort of adopted, a boy called Vastin. Now, first, they went to Mutton Farm. Killed a demon there. Well, they didn't. By mad coincidence, Meristan turns up there with a white thorn, a girl called Samely. They'd been on their way to Haven, to Greytoon, but heard about the demon and... Anyway, they showed up. Samely killed the demon. And she turns out, because Glorbad was hurt in the fight, to be...
He leans forward and waves a performative finger at me.
A healer!
My mouth puckers involuntarily. There's no such thing as healers.
Aye, I can, he says, waving away my scepticism. Just wait. So they all head off for Barrack, except Aranok's got other plans. Because you see, back at Greytoon, Janaeus told him Mornside, where his family's from, had been breached with a blackened. And Aranok wanted to go, but Janaeus said no. And Aranok's intent on going anyway. But Glorbad's no having it. So there's a massive argument, and it ends up with Aranok and Alandria going off on their own to Mornside. Well, they get there and find out Mornside's fine, right? No blackened, nothing. But while they're there, a king's messenger who's been reporting stuff that doesn't chime with what Janaeus knows is murdered in the same pub where they're meeting with Aranok's pa, just before Aranok can speak to her. Suspicious, right? But they've no got time to hang about, so Aranok leaves the town guard to look into it. Oh, also, while they're there, they found out Aranok's niece is a druid. That's important later.
He pauses to take a long slug from his ale, then wipes the suds from his grey beard.
With me so far?
I nod, smiling indulgently. He takes the pause to reevaluate the room, lingers a while on a woman standing by the door until she turns and stalks out into the dreich night. With a quiet,
He turns back to me. So, next morning, the other lot are heading along the old road, and they run into the Blackened. And they are in deep, deep shite. Until Laird Aranok and Alandria show up and bail them out. They make it to an inn. Do you know the White Hart? I nod again. So, with the old road blocked, they reckon the Black Meadows must be clear, right? So they go over the Black Hills and end up at Leperton. The place is abandoned, or so they think. Again with the waving hand. Because what they miss is a blackened baby at the river. And both Vastin and Meristan end up blackened. He sits back, eyes wide, waiting for my reaction. I smile and try to give him the mix of surprise and wonder he craves. It seems to be enough. But then there's this woman, see? Morien. And she's immune to the blackening. And she's got this curse going back through her family. And because of her, Laird Aranok works out that the blackening isn't a plague at all. It's a curse. So this leads to another fight, because now he wants to go to Traveling and work out how to lift the curse, but Glorbad's still all, we've got orders for the king. Anyway, they end up going to Traveling. Oh, but on the way there, I forgot to say before, when they were going to Mutton Hole, they met these demon things that came out of cocoons. Like people, but with four arms and stone skin, but sort of with slatted armour. Anyway, they died in sunlight. The catty. So they run into a bunch of these on the road into Traveling and damn near get killed. But Aranok's got this stone that's been stored in sunlight and he blasts them with it. So they get away. But Vastin's hurt. Bad. When they get to Traveling, Aranok's old teachers, Conifax and Balaban, they find a spell to lift the curse. It works on Meristan, and they've got a plan to do the same to Vastin, and then have Samily use her healing powers on Vastin to save him, right? But it doesn't work out like they thought. Again, he leans in, and his voice falls to barely more than a whisper. Because it turns out, she's no a healer at all, but a time dry. And so both her and the boy end up blackened. They sort her, but they can't lift the boy's curse without him dying from his wounds. So they have to leave him at the hospital. So, they can cure the blackening, right? But how do they cure everyone? Well, Conifax finds mention of a relic called the Heart of Devastation in Caer Amon, which is supposed to massively boost a Drow's powers. And they reckon that might be the very thing. But of course, he spreads his hands wide, massive argument. Aranok says they have to go to Caer Amon. Glorbad says they finally have to go to Barak. In the end, they split up. Aranok, Alandria, and Samily go to Caer Amon. Glorbad, Nyria, and Meristan go to Barak. Oh, another thing. While they're there, Aranok hires a tutor for his niece, a metamorph drow called Raza. That's important later too. Right. So, they head off in opposite directions. Aranok's lot stop off at Mornside and find out they've caught a boy who says he's the dead messenger's husband and that he killed her. But his story doesn't add up. And he ends up cracking his own skull open, supposedly. All a bit off, Ken. Then they stop off to stay with Anhel Weir at Rickett's houses, right? And this is where it gets proper mad. This time, he spends an age looking around the room, carefully examining every drinker, deciding that they're not a threat and moving on. There's some genuine fear in his eyes now. Maybe regret that he began this story. But he can't stop now that he's started. So they stop for dinner at Weir's, he whispers. And he tries to poison them. Because he's a demon summoner. And in fighting off him and his demons, it's them that burn down Rickett's houses. Silence and raised eyebrows. He leaves me to take that in. I give him a considered frown, take a drink of my own. When I say nothing, he continues. Meanwhile, the other lot make it to barrack, except there's nobody there. It's empty. Has been for months. But what there is a demon, and it's waiting for them. Kills Glorbad, nearly kills Nyria. Meristan and her barely make it out alive and run back to Traverlin. Aranok and the others get to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.